Good morning class, welcome back to the another session. In our previous class we have studied about goods and services, and today our topic is wealth and welfare. So first of all, what is wealth? Here wealth means, according to Alfred Marshall, wealth means anything which is useful scare and having physical existence. According to Professor Marshall, wealth means anything which is having usefulness, which is scarce, and having physical existence is known as wealth. So first of all, here is a basic difference. There is a very minute difference, or you can say there is a little difference between goods and wealth. Goods are, you can say that goods are having limited scope, and on the other hand, wealth includes goods in it. So there are some characteristics of wealth. Wealth means general, in general sense, we are considering money. We are considering money as a wealth. But in economics, in a broad sense, money includes wealth includes money, goods, services, as well as intangible goods also, intangible things also. So we are going to see some characteristics of wealth. So the first characteristic of wealth is usefulness. Anything which is useful to humans or an individual is known as wealth, which is having some capability, or you can say the usefulness to satisfy the human wants, then we can say that thing is wealth. For example, house. This is the basic example of wealth. House or vehicle, we are taking two examples here. House and vehicle. So house is useful for what? We are getting shelter from house. Shelter from what? From rainy season, from summer, from winter, we are getting shelter from house. So we can say that there is a usefulness of house. In the same way, vehicle is useful for transportation. We can move from one place to another by using vehicles. So we can also say that vehicle is also having usefulness. So it satisfied human needs or wants. So both these things falls under wealth. There are many examples then that land, machinery, all these examples are considered as a wealth, because machinery is useful for producer to produce goods. Land is useful for constructing roads, buildings, and companies. So all these things falls under wealth, and all these things are having usefulness. So this is the first characteristics of wealth. The second characteristics of wealth is scarcity. So wealth is having scarcity. Anything which is scarce in nature, we can consider as a wealth, or we can say that it possesses the characteristics of wealth. For example, diamond. As you all know, diamond is a very rare good, or you can say rare accessories, which we generally prefer to buy when we are attending any marriage or any function. So here you can see that diamond is very rare goods, which is hardly available, or you can say that diamond is scarce. Because of its scarcity, there is a high price. Diamond is scarce, and because of its scarcity, there is a high in price. You cannot buy diamond for rupees 5,000 or 5 rupees. You cannot buy a diamond for rupees 5 rupees. This is costly more than 50 to 70 thousand. Okay. On the other hand, sunlight. There is a no scarcity of sunlight. You can abundantly use sunlight. We can easily get sunlight. There is no cost for using sunlight. So you cannot consider sunlight as a wealth. Wealth is having the characteristics of scarcity. When the goods or services or any commodity is limited in the nature, then we can say that thing is very useful and possess the characteristics of wealth. So the second characteristics of wealth is scarcity. Wealth is scarce in nature. Scarce means what? Scarce means limited. The synonyms of scarce means limited in nature. Now the third characteristics of wealth is physical and intellectual existence. Any commodity or goods or a product which is physically present, which is physically available, we considered that product or that commodity as a wealth. For example, table, chair, house, vehicles, phone. All these things are physically present in nature. Now for example, I am writing here table. So this table written on the blackboard is just a words, but same table is physically present here, then we can say that it possesses the value of wealth, or we can say that it is physically present. Now for example, I am writing here phone. So it is only written on the blackboard. We cannot consider it as a wealth, but now I am having phone here, so you can say that it is a wealth for me. So in the same way, same for the chair, same for the house, same for vehicle. Anything which is physically present, we considered as a wealth, which is also having usefulness as well as having scarcity. Now what this is the physical presence, and what do you mean by intellectual? Now let me clear this point. Intellectual existent. Suppose I am having any idea of inventing any machinery. So this is my thinking. I am thinking intellectually. I am thinking in my mind. But that idea of producing or manufacturing that machinery, I am implementing, or I am giving the outlet how to produce that machinery. I am giving the outlet and I am giving the procedure to the workers. Now that procedure or that outlet is called as a wealth. Why? Because by using that procedure, you are generating any machinery for further production. For example, I am generating any machinery. Now this machinery will be helpful for the producer to generate product or commodity. So ultimately this machinery will be helpful in generating wealth or money for the producer. So intellectual existence means what? Whatever you are thinking, you are implementing and you are inventing something new. Let me give an example of scientist. Scientists are thinking for constructing home or existing the living world of humans on Mars. But scientists are only thinking. Scientists are only thinking, that falls under intellectual. But existence of what? When scientists are researching and they are trying and they are implementing their plan in actual plan, they are trying to do that in actual life, then we can say that the intellectual thinking comes into existence. Okay, so now the fourth point is exchange value. Any goods or any property or any commodity is having exchange value, then we can say that goods is useful or it is having exchange value. For example, wealth, for example, house. You are purchasing house in 2021. Okay, now you are purchasing house for your personal use. Now after 10 to 15 years you are thinking that I want to sell this house to purchase another house, or you want to move abroad. So what you do, you will sell this house. For example, you are selling this house in 2030. After using this house, then also this house is having exchange value. On the other end, vegetables. After keeping 4 to 5 days any vegetables, for example tomatoes, you cannot exchange this for money with other people. Why? Because these vegetables or dairy product, these things are not having any exchange value. On the other end, land, house, machineries, all these things are having exchange values. Now the fifth characteristics of wealth is durability. As I said here, we can relate this point, durability. Any goods or commodity is having long lasting capacity of providing benefit or satisfying need of human. We can say that that commodity or product is having durability, characteristics of durability. Commercial building. You have already seen that there are many commercial buildings in the market in which there are many shops which operate their functions for earning money. So this commercial building is having more than 30 to 45 years of durability. Okay, so you can say that these things, this building is having a durability of 10 to 20 or 30 years of providing satisfaction or satisfying a need of humans. On the other end, you cannot use food grains. For example, food grains. After 1 or 1.5 years, food grains include wheat. They are not long lasting. They get rotten or they get perished. They get perished after 1 to 2 years, they get perished. Hardly they survive, hardly they are useful for 1 year. On the other end, you can use buildings, machinery for longer period of time. So these are the five characteristics of wealth, and I hope you all are clear with this point. In our next class, we are going to study about this welfare. If you are so, now our next topic is types of wealth. So here there are mainly two types of wealth. That is, first is individual wealth and social wealth. Here, individual wealth is when the ownership of any commodity or any property is belong to an individual or a single person, then we can say that the wealth is individual wealth. Suppose you are having a car. You are having a car. So I can say that the owner of this car is you or an individual. You are the owner of this car, you are the legal user of this car. So by this you can see that the owner of the car is an individual owner, and that means the wealth, car is also falls under a wealth. Any property, any goods, any services, any money. So let me clear one point. Suppose I think you all are in doubt with goods and wealth. You are having doubt that sir is saying that goods, car is also goods, mobile is also goods, but when we are talking about wealth, these goods here, goods and services are having limited scope. On the other end, wealth is having a wider scope. When we are talking about wealth, we are considering what? When we are talking about wealth, wealth includes what? Wealth itself includes goods and services, money, properties, and other intangible so goods and services are included in wealth. Wealth includes what? Goods, services, money, properties, and other intangible things. So the owner of the goods and services, when the owner of the goods and services is a single person, then we can say that it is an individual wealth. There are various examples, as I already said, car, mobile, house, etc. All these are falls under the individual wealth. Now what do you mean by social wealth? Here the word social means public, or you can say society, wealth of society. Social means wealth of society. So here are some of the examples of wealth. For example, dam, railways, public garden, etc. All these are examples of social wealth, because there is no owner, there is no single owner. All these properties are used by society, or you can say more than one people, or you can say the society or an individual or a group of people. Okay, when the group of people are using an commodity or any property, then we can say that property belongs to people, and that falls under social wealth. Okay, now the second point is national wealth. So here national wealth means what? National wealth is a wealth which belongs to its nation. Any wealth which is belongs to its own nation, then we can say that wealth is national wealth. For example, Taj Mahal, Statue of Unity, mountain, rivers, etc. All these examples are of national wealth. Taj Mahal belongs to India. Statue of Unity belongs to India. Mountains, rivers like Ganga, all this belongs to India. Hence, we can say that it is national wealth. On the other hand, what is international wealth? So here, international wealth is a wealth international wealth is a wealth which belongs to whole world. When the property or any wealth belongs to all of the world, including every country, then we can say that wealth is international wealth. For example, World Bank. World Bank is an example of international wealth. Whenever any country is facing any type of financial crisis, they are borrowing money or loan type of creditability from World Bank. So this is their example of international wealth, because the World Bank belongs to all the countries in the world. So I hope you are clear with this point. Now we are moving towards the next point, that is welfare. Our next point is welfare. So what do you mean by welfare? Welfare means nothing but to improve the standard of living. Standard of living of people. To improve the standard of living of the people. When we are improving our standard of living by the means of what? By the means of wealth, then we can say that is a welfare to the society. Now there is a relation between welfare and wealth. The relationship between wealth and welfare. For your kind information, there is one act which is Companies Act. In this act, companies needs to do welfare to the society. For what? As we all know that companies are working on the land, they are using resources which are available in the society. So it becomes their duty to return that favor to the society. So what they are doing, there is one provision that 2% of their earning, 2% of their earning, of their earning means 2% of the earning of the companies to have to be done or have to be allotted for the welfare of the society. Why they are forcing to do welfare? Because they are using the resources which are available in the society. For example, rivers, they are using land for mining, for their production. All these things comes from the society. So it's become their duty, it's become the duty of the businessman or the producer to do a welfare for the society. So welfare, how they are doing welfare? You have seen that there are many gardens, many gardens, public gardens. If you are a localized, then you know the Elecon Garden. So Alicor is a company who is providing these facilities or doing welfare to the society by constructing or by providing a facility of garden. This is the facility of providing garden is a part of doing welfare to the society. Why they are doing welfare? Because they are using resources which are available in the society. I hope you all are clear with this point. If you are having any doubt, please let me know. In our next class, we are going to study further about things. Okay, thank you.